Good morning, everyone. Really happy to be here. So today, I'm Aishwarya Kala, and I work with Pithian. And today, I would like to speak a bit about the use of wallets and encryption. That would be your network encryption, essentially your native network encryption and SSL encryption. So let's begin. So this is about where I work. Pithian, as you have mentioned, and moving on quickly to the agenda. As I mentioned, it's essentially we'll be talking about all the various flavors of encryption that Oracle has for us. Okay. So to begin with, we will first take a look at wallets. What are wallets and why do we need them? So wallet, that does sound something, you know, something that contains valuable information, something that is valuable to us. So similarly for in the Oracle world, wallets are important. And as they say, or as Oracle says, it's a container that stores authentication and signing credentials. So there are two types of credentials that this seems to be talking about, something called an authentication credential and something called the signing credentials. So we'll take a look at what these credentials are all about and why do we really need this. So before we get into this, now wallets can be of a few types. So we'll take a look at that. One would be a password protected wallet. Now a password protected wallet, would be something like a wallet that is secured by a password, right? The name is pretty self-explanatory. The other type of wallet is something that is known as an auto-login wallet. Now, that does not sound too secure. I mean, do you not need a password to secure it? Actually, you don't. So in an auto-login wallet, what happens is your wallet is protected, but it's not protected with a password. Instead, it's protected with your file system permissions. Now, that does not mean that it does not have a wallet. It does not have a password. It has a password. But the thing is, you don't need a password to open this wallet. It is protected based on your file system permissions. There's another type of it. There are essentially two types of auto login wallets. One, as I mentioned, the one that is only protected by your file system permissions, right? And the other is an auto login local flavor of it, where the wallet itself is protected or is bound to the server on which it resides. Now, how does it do that? What it does is it fetches your server name from your host file and it embeds that information in your wallet. Now, why do we need this? What this means is essentially your wallet cannot be transferred over to another server and reused over there, right? So in case of password protected wallets or your auto login wallet, if you have the passwords, or you have the file system permissions that work, you can copy over the wallet to another server and that wallet will work, right? But in case of an auto login local wallet, if you copy over, it will not work. Why? Because it's bound with your server name. So depending on your use case, depending on the way you want to use it, these are the options that you do have in terms of wallets. So again, the server name as well as the owner. So owner applies to both the both types of auto login wallets. So again, the question remains, why do we need a wallet? So this is just something that we can probably quickly skim over. Why do we use passwords in config files for scripts, right? So this is a very common example where you've got a script, you've got a config file which shows a password. Now, the thing to note over here is anybody, a bad actor who has access to your server would be able to view this information. So that deems it less secure. So this is why, and why does this happen? This would happen because when you store your passwords in config files, we usually don't take care of our UMASK. So UMASK permissions, if not set correctly, means that anybody on a server would be able to view the passwords. Okay, so there's another point. You store it in your config file and let's say you protect it. You fix your UMASK, you protect it that nobody else is able to read it. But then again, are you sure that this file is stored at a place which is accessible only to you. If by chance it resides on an NFS share, then that password is pretty much accessible by anybody on the whoever has access to this particular NFS drive. So these are just few random examples where you could consider moving over to wallets instead of saving your passwords in a password file, right? Another thing, when we're talking about sensitive passwords, another thing to consider is that, let's say we save our, we set the permissions, we ensure that it's not on an NFS share, we ensure that the permissions on our files or our script is such that only the owner can view it. But still there's another problem. The problem is you have to be careful with your code. A very common example, I run a backup. As you see over here, my password is visible. And who can look at it? Now, A Kala, that's my login. That's not an Oracle owner. That's not the owner of the Oracle software. That's not the owner of the Oracle process. That's a random user on a server. And that user is able to view your password, right? So you've got to be always careful with your code. So that is why it's always preferable to use a wallet. Again, now let's say you say that, okay, fine, I'll be careful. I will not use my passwords on a command line, right? I'll modify my script. I'll use something like this, where I'm using variables. But then again, in this case, if a person has access to the server, they can still figure out the passwords, you know, by digging in the process variables. There's another way to do it that involves looking at a listener. I've added a link to a third way to do it in an appendix section. You can probably refer it later. But yeah, this is some of the ways in which you can figure out your passwords if you really want to have a go at it. Now, the next slide is probably random. So when we're talking about this, you might consider, I mean, you just might say that we don't want to use a password at all. I just want to use Armand Target / a direct OS authentication. But that is not always an option that is viable. Why? Because if you offload your backups to your standby, this does not work. This simply will lead to this problem. And this is the note about it. And therefore, you will have to use a password. So when you do end up using your passwords, please make sure that it's always advisable to ensure that you protect it using a wallet. Now, just for the kicks, we just noticed an example where we put a Armand password on a command line and any user could grep it and view the password. But what happens when you do it with a SQL plus sys connection? What happens is that SQL plus is smart enough to mask it. Now, this is only with sys connections, right? And not with Armand connections. So this is only when you log in with sys SSDBA. This is the password that Oracle masks. So you're still safe, but any other passwords on command line will be visible, right? So that is something to be careful about. So moving on, how do we create this wallet? We can create the wallet using something called MKStore. Now that's a utility that's available to us. And it's a very simple thing. You give the path where you want to store your wallet. That's your URL, right? You use the MKStore command line utility and you've got to use a password that is strong enough, that is complex enough. And once you have that, you essentially create your wallet. Now, what are the wallet files or what gets created in this directory when you create a wallet? So what you see over here are two files that are created, right? One is your P12, that's your PKCS12 wallet, that's a public key and cryptography standard wallet file. This is the file that contains your credentials. And there's another file called C wallet. Now this is your auto login wallet file, which means that when you create a wallet using MKStore, by default, your wallet is an auto login wallet. The minute you see a C wallet file, it implies that this is an auto login wallet, right? So you create a wallet, what you get is a wallet file, that's your e-wallet that stores your credentials. And there's another wallet, there's another file called C wallet, that's an auto login wallet file, right? So this is what happens when you create a wallet. These are the files that you can see. Of course, these contain the encrypted passwords. Now, you want to create a credential. Credential is something that you store in a wallet, right? So you create a credential again by using mkstore. You provide your command line utility, you provide your options, and you provide the password. So in this example, I want to use my wallet that I just created and store a credential for a user sys, and I want to call that credential testdb_bkp. That's the alias that I want to provide, give to my credential. Okay, so I can create this using this command. And once I create it, I can just list and view my credentials. Now, how do I use the wallet? Your wallet is pretty simply, you can use, there are a couple of parameters for SQLNet.ora that you use. And this gives you the location, and this will give you an override which enforces the use of your wallet. Now, this is pretty standard stuff. But a tip that I'd like to say is whenever you're setting up wallet, it is always a good idea to use a custom SQLNet.ora. What it does is, you modify your variable tns_admin to use your custom SQLNet.ora. What this gives you is the ability to gradually ease in the change. No? For example, if you just want to use a particular password for a particular script, create a custom SQLNet.ora, test it out, let it run for a few days, and see what else can it potentially break. So this is especially important if you're running on 12.1, because there are a couple of bugs. Again, I've listed it in the appendix section. Those bugs, what they do is they can break your SQL plus SysDBA connections. So if there are any implicit split scripts or anything else that's running, any monitoring software or anything else that's running on your server that is trying to use that particular set of binaries, then it will run into error. There's a chance of happening. So it is always a good idea to, just use a separate SQLNet.ora, test it out, identify all the potential scripts that can break so that you can introduce the change, and then roll it in, right? So that's something that's advisable. Again, these are the parameters we talked about. So this is about wallets. Now, are there any maintenance overheads associated with the wallet? Yes, they are. You've got to back up your wallets. Now again, wallets can contain credentials. They can contain the master key that is used for your transparent data encryption. It can contain your SSL certificates. So these are pretty important things. So you've got to back up your wallet. But how do you do this? Do we have a separate utility or something like that? No, we don't. You back it up the way you back up your SQLNet.ora. Take an OS-based backup, right? A file system backup. Or zip it up any way you want to, but back up your wallets so that you have them in case there's a file system corruption or anything of that sort. Another thing that you can do is you can rotate your master keys and save it. Now, master keys can be saved in any password manager that's used by organization, but it's very important to secure this master key. Because if you lose your master key, you will not be able to add any credentials or perform any sort of modifications to your wallet. You still will be able to use it if it is an auto login wallet, but no modifications would be possible, right? Moving on. Now we've looked at mkstore, right? The tool that we use to add credential. Now, there are a few other tools that you can use to manage a wallet. Mkstore, there's the GUI version, that's your Oracle Wallet Manager, and there's something called the Aura PKI. Now, why do we need three different tools? GUI one makes sense. You've got something as a GUI and something for a command line. But why do we have two versions of command line and what are the differences? So as we looked at Mkstore, I just took a Mkstore help. You can see everything over here is dealing with credentials. You create a credential, you're doing something, you're deleting an entry, you're listing the credential, you're modifying the credential, but everything is usually around credential, right? So whenever you want to store a user credential, this is the tool you want to use, okay? Similarly, whenever there's something around wallets, around CRL, around certificates, this is the certificate revocation list, and anything about JavaSafe, anything around these things, you used Aura PKI. So this is where the difference creeps in. If I want to see the contents of the wallet, I do a list credential. I see there is a the account that we created, the password that we stored. Similarly, if I do an Aura PKI display of the wallet, the contents that I then see are something called certificates. And if you notice, the credentials are not listed over here and the certificates are not listed over here. So this is where the difference creeps in. So depending on what you want to change, you will need to use the appropriate tool. So to summarize, these are the differences. When you want to work with your credentials, this is what you use. When you want to work with all these things, Aura PKI is what you use. Okay. So this is about wallet. Right. So when we discussed wallet, the first thing that we said that wallet contains credentials. It would be your authentication as well as your signing credentials, right? So let's take a look at encryption and then we'll move on to the signing credentials. So before, I mean, this is just some basic overview of encryption. As you know, this is a standard transfer of data where your data is unencrypted. Anybody can view the message contained in this packet, right? This can contain credentials, sensitive information. Now the thing is when you initiate a new connection to your database, right? You provide your database username and password. Now that information by default is always encrypted. But once that session is established, any further information that will not be encrypted in a non-encrypted session by such. So database credentials will be protected, but nothing else. So this is something over here. Now you move on. Again, sorry, this is what your encrypted message would be. You somehow encrypt it and you pass along. If there is a bad actor on your network, they would not be able to decipher the text that's in your message, right? So this is what encryption is all about. Now, the thing is, how do we do this? So something that we use to do encrypt things is called a key. Or in our case, or as from a database perspective, we'll call this session key. So the key is over here, you encrypt it, you have an plain text, you encrypt it using a key, you get a ciphered form of text, you send it across, you decrypt it using the same key. This is the way it will work. Pretty straightforward. Now, there are two types of keys that are involved. First would be an symmetric encryption, where the same key is used to encrypt as well as decrypt. You know, you use this key, you encrypt the data, and at the target, you use the same key, you decrypt the data. Similarly, there's another mechanism where, you know, you call it asymmetric encryption. What happens over here? Here, you use a key to encrypt it, and you use another key to decrypt it. And we've all used this. This is nothing but your public-private key pair, right? Your public key is shared, you request the client to encrypt the data using the public key and you decrypt it using your private key. So this is asymmetric encryption. Now, if you take a look at both these encryptions, symmetric has a very key benefit of being better with performance. And that's what we want for our database. We don't want to introduce something that's slower. So the risk that is involved is with symmetric, that you don't want anybody to snoop and figure out your symmetry key, right? The session key, that is, because once they have the key, they will be able to decrypt your data as well, right? Now with the asymmetric encryption, it's really safe because you are never sending your private key anywhere. That's always with you on your server. But the problem again here is that it's slower. So these are a few algorithms that are supported by these formats, but all in all, this is where the, you know, the risk and the reward kind of varies and we need to balance it out. Let's take a look at how Oracle does this. So database network encryption. So there are three flavors of encryption. One would be your native network encryption. The other would be network data integrity. And the third would be your SSL or what we call TLS, right? So looking at your network, oh yeah, very important point. None of these are a part of advanced security options. So this is from your security guide, so your security handbook. Your network encryption and strong authentication services are no longer a part of this, the Oracle Advanced Security, and are available in all licensed editions for all releases. So we pretty much don't have to pay extra for these options. So again, these options, they are configurable at client side. All the three options that we talked about, they can be configured for a particular client, or they could be configured for a particular server, which means they are enforced across all the clients. So we have an option to, you know, configure it either way. Let's take a look at native network encryption. So this is perhaps one of the easiest ones to implement. Now, this is what we know, talked about earlier, the encryption that we have, and our key was, or the main important point was the session key that we talked about. Now, what we need to do over here in this scenario is the client and the server need to negotiate a key, which will be based on an algorithm that both these computers essentially support, right? So how do we do that? Let's take a look. To do that, we've got two parameters that are actually control this entire cycle. The first is encryption underscore server, right? Now this can be on the server side and client side, as we talked about earlier. This is set in sqlnet.ora. And this has four values: required, requested, accepted, and rejected. Now this is the important bit, and we'll just talk about it once. The rest of it would be pretty self-explanatory. So what happens with required is that you are essentially forcing encryption. That is, once you set the parameter, let's say I want to enforce it for all the clients connecting to my database. So I set the parameter required on my server side, right? So what I'm doing is I'm forcing native encryption. Similarly, if I use requested, I'm going to request a native encryption. That is, I'm going to request all my clients that, hey, if you support encryption, can you send me your preferred algorithm? But if you do not support encryption, that's okay. I'm going to allow a connection. I'm not going to refuse connection. So it's going to allow the connection for unencrypted sessions as well, right? The third type is accepted. Now, the difference between requested and accepted is, if you set the parameter value to accepted, it is going to accept the connection. And any, like if a client wants to initiate a network or an encrypted session, it's going to accept it, it's going to allow it. But from itself, it's not going to initiate. That is, it's not going to ask the client that, hey, do you support native encryption? That is a question that your server will not ask. It's only going to accept it. And the third is outright rejected. Now, this is something that disables network encryption, right? So these were the four values. As you can see, this is the least secure. This is the most secure. You're going to reject it. If the client initiates, you're going to accept it, but you're not initiating it. If you are running in a requested mode, then you're requesting it. And of course, required, you're enforcing it. So these are the four modes in which you can set up your encryption, and the four values which this parameter can take. Now, based on the combination of these values on your server side and client side, your encryption, whether your connection would be encrypted or not, will be decided. We'll take a look at that as well. And this is how it works. So in this table, what you see, let's take a look at rejected first. So as the word suggests, if your parameter is set to rejected on server side as well as client side, or almost everywhere, your native network encryption would be disabled, right? As you can see, it's rejected at the server side. It's disabled, it's disabled, it's disabled. Similarly over here, it's disabled, it's disabled. But if your server side says, I'm rejecting any connection that's encrypted, and your particular client says that, hey, I only believe in encrypted connections, then the connection will be refused. So please note, when I say disable, it means that the connection has been established and it's an unencrypted connection, but your database connection has been established. But in this case, when one side wants to reject it and the other side needs it, you know, it enforces it, in that case, your database connection will just not work. Okay. And again, similarly, let's take a look at the other end. If it's required, right, if the server requires it, then your network encryption will be enabled unless your client refuses it, right? So similarly for requested, if one side requests encryption and the other side is able to provide encryption, then it's enabled. But the only thing over here is this, the accepted thing, right? If the server side accepts encryption and the client side accepts encryption as well. Now notice, none of them are requesting, they're just accepting. So client is waiting for server to initiate, the server is waiting for the client to initiate. But since both of them are marked as accepted, nobody initiates. And hence, the connection that will be established would be a non-encrypted connection. And this is the default value of these parameters. So by default, your encryption is never enabled. It's just left in an accepted mode, such that if there's a client that wants to encrypt it, well, it will happen. But yeah, by default, it's disabled. Okay. So this is your table that explains the reason or the way these values work. Okay. So now we've decided that we want to encrypt our, based on these settings, we've decided that we want to encrypt the communication. Okay, fair enough. But what algorithm to use? So this is the other parameter, the second parameter, where you, the server, at both the server side and client side, depending on the version of your software, you determine, or your security policies, you determine which, these are the algorithms that are available. This is the strength. You determine which one you want to use, and you can, you know, you can pass it along as a list of values. Now the first match is selected. So you just put it, you know, you can have it, you can provide a list as encryption underscore types underscore server equal to AES 128 comma AES 256. Now if the server as well as the client both support AES 128, then they will use that particular algorithm to generate a session key. So this is something that is known as key negotiation, right? So now we have everything there. Now, the only change over here is that suppose we were talking about, we mentioned that whenever I require a connection, I require encryption, if other sides support it, my encryption would be established, right? If my connection would be an encrypted connection. But there's one catch. Now, suppose you say required and the server and the client both are set to required. However, they do not have a matching algorithm. This has an algorithm list that differs from the algorithm list of the client. In that case, even though they can support, both of them can support encryption, they cannot agree on a key, a common key. In that case, again, you'll receive this error. The session will not get established because of no matching algorithms, right? So because both the sides require, but they are not able to establish common grounds or establish or negotiate a common key, they will not be able to establish a connection with the database. So this is about your native network encryption. Now, just similar to native encryption, there's something called data integrity. Why do we need this? This is essentially because if there are any changes in your data packet that's traversing your network, this is something that will protect it, right? This will protect it against your data modification or replay attacks. And every data packet, what happens over here, every data packet, it assigns a checksum value to that packet. And if any data in that packet is altered, the checksum value will also alter. So this will indicate that the packet has been tampered with. So in order to use this, again, you've got the same, like you had encryption underscore server, you've got crypto checksum server. The same four values, just the way we looked at it earlier. And for algorithms, MD5, SHA1, SHA2, these are the algorithms that you have for your data integrity, right? So pretty much like your encryption, you've got your integrity algorithms. So to conclude, your native network encryption has two things. One is your integrity algorithms and the other is your encryption algorithms. And you don't have to use them, both of them together. You can use either or any combination, right? It's recommended to use both so that, you know, you get encrypted conversation or encrypted session, right? As well as you maintain the integrity of the traffic or the data that is being transferred across your network. And as we noticed, very simple to configure. There are just two parameters for each of them that you need to use. You can choose, there are a list of keys or a list of algorithms from which you can choose. Thing to note, this is a symmetric crypto system, which means it's pretty quick, right? And another thing to note is that keys are valid for only one session. So for example, you've got a really long running batch job that runs for, let's say, 10 hours. Your session key does not change for all the entire duration of the session. So any negotiation back and forth, you know, the data is getting sent back to the client through the session key remains the same. And if you look at it this way, for example, you've got a client or you've got an application that establishes connections over and over again, right? It establishes a connection, does an insert, drops the connection. Now, from before every insert, a new session key would be negotiated. So the key negotiation is dependent, or it happens at the beginning of the session. So it's session dependent, not the work that's being done by the session. It's got nothing to do with that. Okay? So just to keep in mind. So this is about network encryption. So I can show a quick demo about this, how to set this up. You know, we talked about all these parameters. Let me just look at this. So this is my session. I've just logged on to a database. I establish a connection as SysDBA. Now this is a view. This is a very important view, and this is the view from which we can figure out how to determine if our session is encrypted or not. You know, you've got something called $V session connect info where you can check the network service banner. So as you can see, it says that this is a BigQuery connection and these are the services that are offered, but I don't see any algorithms being used over here yet. Okay. So I don't want to do this. I want to establish a TCP connection or TNS connection. Let's do that. And these are the connections of this is the content of my SQLNet.ORA. So I have literally nothing. I've just got a directory path set as of now. So let's see what happens. Let me just check my network banner again. Again, this is a TCP connection. I don't have any algorithms listed. I'm using the same $V session connect info, right? Now let me enable network encryption. What do I mean? I just set a parameter, crypto checksum and encryption, both of them I marked as required. What happens? By default, I can see an encryption algorithm being used. I can see a crypto check summing algorithm being used, right? So this means that the particular connection that I established, again, this was done. This is an encrypted connection, which is done using an AES-256 algorithm for encryption and SHA-1. Now, suppose instead of this, my security policies ask me to, you know, enforce an MD5 crypto check summing service. What do? I modify my SQLNet.ORA and I put in the algorithm that I want to use. Once I do this, I reconnect. And as the minute I reconnect, I can see this is the sum. This is the, excuse me, this is the one that, sorry, this is the algorithm that I'm using now, right? So it's pretty straightforward. You just have to play around with your SQLNet.ORA and on your client as well as server. So this is about native network encryption. I'll just skip this part. We've already seen this in the demo. So the next part about this talk is about the TLS and SSL bit of it. Now, this is what we were looking at as of now, right? We had a secure connection that was encrypted and all my data packages had data integrity algorithms attached as well, right? Now, the problem over here, if you notice, is that what happens over here? Let's see, this is a demo user. I want to connect to this database. I send across my key, right? I secure my data, I send the key across. Now if say there's somebody snooping on my network, they grab hold of my key. They say that, okay, I am demo, I am this client. The database has no way of determining is this computer saying the truth or is this one saying the truth? How do I trust if my client is authentic or not, right? The database has no way of determining this in a particular native network encryption. It has no way of establishing the identity, right? That is where your TLS or your SSL comes into play. How? Let's see this. Now, the SSL adds a third layer, which is known as authentication, or your trust, as we commonly call it, the SSL certificates, that is trust, right? They add authenticity to this conversation. And how does this happen? This happens in this way. The client will say, hey, I want to connect to you. Can you confirm your identity? The database will say, sure, here's the proof. This is something like you showing your ID card when you're trying to establish or you were trying to enter a place. You establish your proof that, hey, I'm a valid person. I need to enter this building. I have the authority and I'm certified or I have this badge that says that, right? So in a similar manner, database says, here's the proof. I'm the correct server. Connect to me. The client says, okay, look at my identity. Once everybody has verified their papers, okay, let's establish a connection. We'll then think about using your encryption and your data integrity. But first, we establish, are you saying the truth or not? So this is authenticity. How does that happen? Via certificates. So let's take a look at how do we do this? What is this all about? Okay. So in your certificate is not, sorry for this, right? So when I talk about certificates are something similar to your, I can say not similar, but metaphorically similar to your employee badges, where you trust your employer to provide you with a authentic employee badge, okay? So when you look at somebody and somebody says that, hey, I'm employee ID ABC1234, you can look at the badge and validate, okay, this is a valid employee badge. It says that this is employee 1234. I can pass along this sensitive information to employee ID 1234. It validates, it checks out, right? So similar, in a similar case, there is something called a certificate authority, which is tasked with providing these certificates to all organizations to establish their validity. Now, certificate authority, it would be a massive task for one single certificate authority to validate all the organizations across the world. So in that case, the certificate authority has kind of subdivided its work into multiple smaller authorities. And as an organization, we can approach these authorities and they will validate, they will verify our identity, our address, and they will provide us with signed certificates, right? And this is something which is known as, it forms a chain of trust. So before I go into that, sorry, again, not sure why this is happening today, but this is the way it works. So again, let's take a look at this example. Again, in the same, I was talking about my demo user, they want to connect to your database, right? So it goes over here and it gives you the papers that, here's my identity and the possible ciphers I want to use while I want to encrypt my conversation in future. Now, what your database will do is it will pass along your certificate, the certificate that it has received from a certificate authority, along with its public key, right? That's the second thing that goes, because you need a key to encrypt your data. So over here, what we're doing is the database is sending across its public key to the client. The client is then verifying the certificate. Okay, this certificate is an authentic certificate. I trust this authority. And along with it, it has also received the public key of the database server. Now, once that's done, the client can send across its own certificate, right? And if you notice, it has encrypted this certificate with the public key that it had received, right? This has, now what, the database server does, the database server has a private key which it can use to unencrypt this information. So the client has sent across its own public key, which is encrypted by the public key of the server. Okay. So in step number one, my client sent requests a connection. In step number two, my database server sends across my certificate with the public key. In step number three, my client uses that public key to encrypt its own certificate as well as the public key, client public key. Now the database server has the public key, which it can encrypt in. Okay. Now the database server has the public key of the client side. So as you see, both the public keys have been exchanged, right? Now the client has the server public key and the server has the client public key. After both the public keys have been exchanged, they decide on the algorithm that they want to use. Based on the algorithm, they determine the server, they determine the session key, and then they establish a connection. So this is known as an SSL handshake, right? You go through these steps. What essentially is happening is we're using a asymmetric encryption. No, you just exchange your public keys to generate a session key, which will be symmetric, which can be then used for further communication. Because once you've got a session key, now this has a session key and this has a session key, which is symmetric. Now the real data that will be transferred across the client and the server, that will be encrypted by using this session key. The same session key will be used to decrypt it. So that would become a symmetric conversation. So this is the way your SSL handshake works. Now, we talked about the certificate authority earlier. You can visit this link and you can get a list of a lot of information about your certificates and what is a certificate chain and how these actually work. But the thing of importance is that certificate is just used to establish trust and authenticity of the participating servers in the conversation. Now, how do we implement this? So first of all, again, we create a wallet, right? In the wallet, what we do is we create a certificate signing request. Now, this is something that we're going to send across to the to your certificate authority. For this, what you can use is you can use Aura PKI and you can add your domain name and request a certificate, right? You're providing your domain name, you're providing the signing algorithm that you want to use. And if you notice, it's a requested certificate. Now you want to extract the certificate and you want to send it across to your CA. So these are the commands where you can do this, right? Set of commands. You generate your CSR, that is nothing but your certificate signing request, and you send it across to your certificate authority for verification. And if you take a look at the certificate, the CSR, you can see the sign, you can verify that the signing algorithm is what you wanted to use, right? Now, the thing if you notice is that we're using OpenSSL over here, and initially, we created this using Aura PKI. Now, why the difference? The reason is simply because there's a bug with the, I think it's FIT 12C, I'm not sure about 19C, but it's certainly there with 12C, where with Aura PKI, you are not able to generate a certificate request with SHA-256 algorithm. So for that reason, we have to use OpenSSL to generate the CSR. So once you've generated a CSR, you've got it verified, the CA will review it, it will sign it, and it will send it back to you. Once you get back the certificate, you can see things like validity of the server. You can see, is it an interim server? Is it a user-based certificate? Now, user certificates is the certificates that identifies your organization. And your interim or your root certificates are the certificates that essentially identify the signing authority themselves, okay? So what you need to do is you need to separate out these certificates. This is a file, you can do a VI or any other command, OS level commands, depending on your OS. You just separate these certificates out into separate files. Once you get that, you've got to add your trusted certificate to your wallet and your user certificate to your wallet. So this is a user certificate that verifies your organization. These are the certificates that verify the signing authority. And as you, once you add it back, see I'm adding over here. The minute I add it back, I can see them, that they are listed in my wallet. So this way you've imported signed certificates into your wallet. Now, once I've done this, again, This is the wallet location parameter that we looked at when we were discussing wallets. So this is set in sequinel.ora, and you also need to set it on listener.ora so that your listener is able to use a secure channel. How do we do this? Right, another parameter that you need to do is SSL version. This is something that controls your TLS 1.2 or TLS 1.1 implementation. So this parameter, set it to 1.2 if you want to use TLS 1.2, okay? Another thing is, with this comes a set of cipher suits. Now, what are the cipher suits? Cipher suits are nothing but the list of algorithms that each will use. So for example, if you're using this particular cipher suit, this is the authentication algorithm, this is the encryption algorithm, and this is the data integrity algorithm. It's a combination of the three. And the thing to be careful about over here is that if you're using TLS 1.2, you should use a cipher suit that is compatible with TLS 1.2. Otherwise, again, your security level will be degraded. Okay. So once you've determined all these parameters, you've set it in your sequinel.ora, the next thing that you need to do is you need to set up a TCPS endpoint. Let's say I want my listener to listen to 2484 port for TCPS protocol. That's the secure protocol. I set this up. I am adding an additional listener. I stop my scan listener. I restart it. I stop my listener. I restart it. Okay. I update my local listener so that TCPS is used. This is 2484 and TCPS port is used. This is what I need to implement my SSL on my server side. Now, in case I want to use client certificates as well, in that case, I need to export my client certificates and send it across. I need to get my client certificates and import it into my wallet as well, right? Let's say we've implemented this, and now I want to verify my protocol. I want to verify that the connection that's coming from a client, is it encrypted? For that, what I can do is this. So if I look over here, I can see that SSL is being used. Why? Because my secure port is being used. Okay. Another way to do is by using OpenSSL. I can connect to the client. This is the host name. This is the DNS, and this is the port. And I can see that this is the protocol is being used. This is the protocol that is being used. The cipher that is being used. So I can verify both the things. Where do I use it other than database connections? I can use it with OEM to secure my OMS. I can use it in my mail server to authenticate if I've got a package that is sending email and I want my emails to be encrypted, I can use the wallets in that case as well. Are there any maintenance overhead? Yes, an extremely important maintenance overhead is the certificate expiry. If you look at this, this command is going to give you the certificate expiry. And if your certificate expires, and please be very extremely careful with this, if your certificate expires, your database connections will not happen. Your client will stop connecting to your database. It can lead to a potential outage. So you have to renew your certificates before they expire. Okay. So this is something that's really critical with SSL. Now, how do I troubleshoot this? If you want to troubleshoot it, you can enable tracing. Otherwise, you can use things like Wireshark. In order to do this, you just need to identify the NIC associated with your TCPS port. You know, I do an IP config, figure out the Ethernet port that's associated, use TCP dump to snoop your network, listen to this session, generate a trace, and then you can open your trace using Wireshark. When you open your trace using Wireshark, it looks something like this. Yep. You can see that it's a TLS version 1.2. Sometimes, you know, a very simple use case, auditors want proof of something like this, screenshots. This is something that you can use in that case as well. Again, I think I'm running short of time. Let me just quickly wrap this up. A quick comparison between native network encryption and TLS. Now, native network encryption, as we have seen, it's very simple to implement. There are just two parameters, server side and client side, that we need to set up: the required, requested, accepted thing, and the list of algorithms. And we can encrypt our data and we can provide data integrity algorithms, right? There is no maintenance overhead. There's nothing that expires, nothing that needs to be renewed. The problem over here is lack of trust. With TLS, the configuration is a bit tricky. You need to, I mean, it involves a lot more steps. You need to go to your certificate authority. You need to get a signed certificate. There's certainly a overhead of being careful about certificate expiry. You know, that's the thing where we've been bitten. So, yep, be super careful about it. A possible performance overhead because there is a bit of asymmetric encryption involved in the step where we are transmitting our session keys. So that's an overhead, but it is the most secure protocol that's out there and it meets the industry standards. Everyone is gravitating towards TLSV version 1.2. Although Oracle itself states that native network encryption is more than enough, especially if you've got a configuration where most of your servers are in-house. In that case, you are not really talking with anybody outside the firewall, so you don't need the TLS setup. Native network encryption is a very secure way to go about it. There's another parameter called encryption seed that you can use with native encryption to add the complexity. But all in all, this is what is all about. And can we use both together? Prior to 19c, you could not. With 19c, you can. For some clients, you can use native network encryption. For the remaining, you can use SSL-based encryption. So that option is available starting 19c. So with this, I think I'll end. I've got a few things if you want to look at, for example, what happens during wallet upgrades or ASM does not support SSL and stuff like that, and which you can refer whenever you want to. But with this, I think I'm done. So if you have any questions.
Thanks, Aish. No, actually, we had one question, but you already answered it during the presentation.